Welcome to The Clear Spot, where in this programme we're talking about the voice from scientific, poetic and artistic perspectives. This programme is a kind of exploratory foray or an initial sounding out of ideas which are going to be discussed at greater length and in greater depth on Friday the 16th of November at the Science Museum's Dana Centre in London. The Voice Symposium, as this event is called, brings together scientists, including neuroscientists, biologists and linguistics researchers, together with artists, musicians and poets, around the common topic of the voice. If this sounds like your thing, there's a website where you can find out further details about timings of the day and how to get tickets, and that's www.thevoxlab.org/symposium. And if you can't make the live event, Resonance are going to be recording the proceedings and they'll be broadcast sometime around the end of the year. Four of the speakers who'll be at the symposium have joined me in the studio today to talk about their interests and their work, so we'll be playing some sound clips and talking to them and playing some pieces by other contributors too. My name's James Wilkes and I'm currently the poet in residence at UCL's Institute of Cognitive Neuroscience, where I'm working with the Speech Communication Lab, finding about their research into the ways in which the human brain produces and processes speech. And my first guest is Professor Sophie Scott, who leads the Speech Communication Group at the ICN. Sophie, I've had the opportunity to spend some time with you and your lab, so I know what a wide range of interests you have and the kind of things you're working on, anything from research into emotional vocalizations like laughs or the sounds we make when we're disgusted, or through to studies of what happens when two people try to speak in sync with each other. So to get things started, I just thought I'd play you a quick clip of a rather unusual piece of speech and we can maybe go from there. So, yes, a beluga whale trying to speak like a person.
Yes, it is quite extraordinary. Evidently, the people that heard it thought it was somebody talking to them. A diver came to the surface because they thought somebody was saying, get out, you need to get out. It is really striking. There's a handful of species around the world that can learn vocally. And there are some sea mammals like this beluga whale, humans, some passerine birds, songbirds, and they're born with this ability to learn new vocal repertoires, which lots of animals can make noises, but they don't learn new songs, learn new words. And there are these really nice examples of the beluga whale. There was a sea lion called Hoover who could talk like humans. And recently there was an elephant reported who was producing actual words. They're all making them in different ways. So the elephant's making sound by rattling his trunk inside his mouth as he breathes out. The beluga whale is sort of shunting air around inside passengers inside his head. And the sea lion was actually vocalising like I am by making noise at his larynx. They're all doing it in different ways, but they're aiming it all at actually producing similar sounds to what humans do when they talk.
So, I mean, that's quite an interesting thing, the fact that these animals have such different kinds of vocal apparatus and yet they're kind of converging on human speech. I mean, in what ways are we adapted to make the noises that we do that we call speech?
Well, humans are adapted to do talking in a number of very specific ways. So first of all, we walk upright. So when we do this, we free up our rib cage to do something other than support our weight. And what this shows itself in is the way that when we breathe to stay alive, we take a breath in and then we just use elastic recoil of the intercostal muscles, the muscles between the ribs, for air to come straight back out again. It's done its job. We've got some oxygen into the system and we've taken away carbon dioxide. If we breathe to speak, we breathe completely differently. We do a breath in and now you do incredibly finely controlled movements of the intercostal muscles to force air up through at the right sort of subglottal pressure through the larynx. And if I keep speaking without taking another breath, you can hear my intercostal muscles are starting to need to squeeze air out from my lungs. In the end, my voice completely runs up and I need to breathe again. Now, that seems very, you know, like, why would that be of interest? But actually, you have incredible fine control of your intercostal muscles that makes that possible. And it is impossible if you need to use your ribcage to support your weight. So if you try and do press-ups when you're talking, you get some sensation of how much harder it is. And noticeably, the talking elephant was doing a single word on each single exhalation. He couldn't produce sentences because he's having to stand on his four legs. But what this gives us is this rather beautiful ability to produce long, modulated sequences of sound. We don't need to talk like that, which is how the elephant was talking and how I would have to talk if I was doing press-ups. And then we make this sound at our larynx, which is essentially, it was, in evolutionary terms, something that was evolved to keep things from dropping into your lungs. And when you speak, that's the larynx, yes. You bring your vocal folds together, and instead of just using them to stop peanuts dropping down there, you blow air up through them, and you vibrate them together by forcing air up through. But very similar to a kazoo, basically, is a rattling the vocal folds. And this gives a buzzing sound. So if you go and then go zzz, while you put your fingers on the top of your neck, just below your jaw, you can feel something vibrating.
I feel it resonating.
And that's the vibrations of your larynx. Now, interestingly, you only really feel that vibration if you put your fingers there, because we don't have any sensation in the larynx itself. You don't feel that vibration when you're making it. However, we then have this fat sound, which we shape with everything that comes above the larynx. And in humans, this is another location of an adaptation, because the larynx in other mammals and in human babies sits up at the back of the tongue, and it's closing off the airways by having a sort of, you know, by sitting at the back of the mouth. In humans, we have a descended larynx, so that means we've got a longer pipe with which to make the sounds of speech. It literally lets us make much more rich spectral sounds, and also it frees up the tongue. The tongue isn't anchored at the back of the mouth by the larynx, which it is in chimpanzees and it is in human babies. And this means the tongue can perform extraordinary vocal dynamics. Can I say that again? This means the tongue can produce extraordinary gymnastics inside the mouth. And it really does. It's hard to imagine. We're only really starting to use the modern techniques now to image exactly how much movement there is inside your mouth when you're speaking. But it's extraordinary. And what that's doing is, along with your lips and your soft palate and your teeth, you are shaping the sound that you make at the larynx, and shaping it very rapidly in a very coordinated way. And that actually then gives you speech sounds.
And I think you and your lab have done some work with people who are able to kind of use their articulators, use their teeth and their tongue in unusual ways. What kind of things did you find?
We've done some work with beatboxers, and I used to start all my talks by saying, oh, human speech is the most complex sound in nature. It's the most amazingly complex motor thing that we do. And then I met beatboxers, and I realised that we are just sitting back and putting our feet up, really, when we're speaking, because they produce amazingly complex sounds. One guy, we did some recordings with him, and we were recording from his larynx as well as recording the sound he was making. And this is a chap called Reeps One. He was doing things like setting up a sound by making a zzz sound at his larynx, then seamlessly picking that sound up at his lips, so that to anybody listening wouldn't realise that actually the sound had broken at all. You're hearing a buzzing sound carrying on. Then once he's picked it up at his lips by sort of doing a raspberry, except it's much better than that, he then starts doing something else at his larynx, and then starts producing sort of harmonic sounds in his nasal passages. So he's producing three separate sources of sounds, which according to many theories of phonetics, you shouldn't be able to do. So they're doing this with such rapidity. It's early days, and this is very much work driven by Carolyn McGettigan, but it does look as if the people who can beatbox have found a way of driving their vocal apparatus that sort of is overwhelming a lot of the stuff that's usually there for speech, and is much more resembling somebody playing a series of musical instruments. They really do produce polyphonic sound.
So Carolyn McGettigan is going to be talking later on in the programme. And one of the things I wanted to ask is if this is kind of producing a kind of auditory illusion. I mean, you're saying so effectively people pick up on a continuous vibrating sound, whereas actually that's an illusion created by these different parts of the mouth.
Absolutely, and that's something you find very, very commonly when people are producing, say, orchestral music, where you have lots of different instrumental voices in there, using these sorts of illusions of how a sound is being carried, how a tune is playing out across different instruments, is something that composers have long used, and people working with choirs and all sorts of things. And it's amazing to see one person doing it inside their own vocal apparatus.
Yeah. Well, I think later on in the programme we will talk a bit more about auditory illusions, so maybe you'll have some other things to say to that. But I was wondering if you could say a few things about the work we've been doing with laughter and with other kind of forms of emotional explosion, as it were.
Well, one of the things that I'm really interested in is sound, and one of the reasons I like speech is because it's a very, very complicated sound. And I became interested in other sorts of things that we do to express meaning when we are sort of, you know, engaging in communication in the world. And I got very interested in non-verbal vocalizations of emotion, so expressions of emotion that you do with your voice. And of course, we do this all the time when we are expressing, you know, a humour. Every so often you do encounter somebody who goes, "That was very funny." Most of the time, people laugh, and that's the way that you're actually showing this behaviour. And they're very, very interesting. I got interested in this initially for reasons of sort of trying to work with patients who had particular problems recognising different emotions. But then I just got very interested in them as a collection of things that we do, because they are actually much more like animal calls than they are like speech. We make them in a very different way, and they seem to pair a lot more in common with the sort of involuntary emotional vocalizations and other sorts of communication calls that you find throughout the rest of, you know, certainly the primate world. And that's because you don't actually do a lot of this shaping with your mouth. You maybe pull one particular facial expression, but then the rest of the work's all really being done with the pitch of the voice and the quality of the voice. So that's a sort of general thing across all of them. You don't need to do all the things you need to do for speech to make these sounds. They are older. They seem to reflect something just older in our evolutionary history. And that's there in how we make them as well. And then within that, I got very, very interested in laughter, because laughter is essentially more like a different way of breathing than it is anything else. And unlike the other sounds where you're sort of producing something at the larynx, the propulsive force for laughter is coming about through contractions of the intercostal muscles. And do you remember I said when you're talking or breathing, you're using your intercostal muscles to take air in and then either breathe out or produce a controlled flow of air for speech. And when you laugh, you completely get overwhelmed by this contractions of the intercostal muscles. So it stops normal breathing, because all you're doing is exhaling. When you have this contraction, air is being forced out. And then if you try and speak, it just is disastrous for your speech. You make extraordinary, ridiculous noises. There are a few examples of people sort of corpsing live on air and desperately trying not to laugh. And they start to, there's nothing they can do about it. The motor system just gets totally overwhelmed by it. So it's very interesting in terms of, well, I'd like to know more about why it's so overwhelming. But also it's very striking that we aren't, as I sort of suggested earlier, we aren't the only animals that laugh. So I think Nietzsche said man had to invent laughter because only he sort of understood how tragic life was. But he was completely wrong, because all sorts of other animals laugh, and they laugh in very similar ways. So chimpanzees, orangutans, all the way around to rats, you find laughter, and you find it in very, very similar settings. So you find it when animals are tickled, when animals are playing, even to the point in adult chimpanzees, they have different laughs that reflect whether or not they're being tickled or if they are trying to make play continue. Very much like human adults have different laughs depending on whether or not we are helpless with laughter or if we are actually laughing socially with our friends. And although most of the time, if you ask people what makes you laugh, they'll talk about jokes and humour, if you look at when people laugh, they laugh when they're with their friends. So it's actually
a social
emotion. Yeah.
I was going to ask actually about that difference, because clearly being tickled is not funny in the sense of humour. You know, it's a much more physical reaction. So how do those things diverge? When do they come apart? And do they ever kind of come back together? What, there's a sort of thing there that doesn't actually seem to fit together.
I think that tickling is a bit of a red herring, because I suspect that tickling only exists to get laughter going. It's where you always find the first laugh. So if you're a baby rat or you are a baby orangutan or you're a baby human, laughter first emerges around 2.5 months when those infants are tickled, normally by a parent. Mm. And that has the effect of making the parents laugh. So it has you get this interaction from its outset. Laughter is elicited in interactions. You can't tickle yourself. And then as babies grow up, and I think you can't underestimate the importance of those initial laughs, because anybody who's been around a human infant knows, you know, what they've mostly done up to that point is scream at you or they've been asleep. And then suddenly you get these peals of mirth, and it's the first proper interaction, vocal interaction of behaviour that you get. And of course, we prime it massively. It makes us laugh, that makes the baby laugh. Yeah. You get these cycles set up. Then you see it developing. So throughout childhood, it's strongly associated with play. All mammals play. There's a facial expression associated with play, which is a sort of loose, happy, smiling face. And where people have looked for it, they also find that there's laughter. So certainly in human infants, or children, when they're playing, they laugh all the time. Show, this is a game, this is a game. And then in adulthood, it's important as this social bonding emotion. So I think it's that it starts with tickling, just as a way of getting it off the ground, because it's so important to mammals. And then it gets carried through and becomes more social and more associated with humour. So it took me a long while working in laughter to realise that probably it wasn't all about humour. Actually, most of the time, laughter, most of the time, is a sign of affiliation, of agreement, of affection. You're showing people that you like them when you laugh with them, and you're showing that you would like them to like you. It's reflecting that dynamic. And I think it's very interesting that we've sort of culturally found a way where we can go and do that in big groups, where we put one person on the stage and then we all look at them and we wait for them to make us laugh. But I think that's an unusual situation. The normal context of laughter is the rather more social environment.
And how do you get people to laugh when you're putting them in a scanner? That's the big question.
We haven't actually made anybody laugh in the scanner yet. We're trying to think of ways we can do it without catastrophic motion artifacts. We have done studies looking at the difference between absolutely, you know, laughter you cannot but emit when you are helpless with laughter versus deliberate posed laughter, which of course most social laughter is. You are voluntarily laughing. And to do that, we just did whatever it took. We put people in the anechoic chamber and short of going in and tickling them, we just did whatever it took. So, for example, what made me laugh was watching Carolyn listening to something that made her laugh, and that was enough. I could just laugh all day because I knew what she was listening to. I didn't need to hear it. So we just did whatever it took to actually elicit these. And it is extraordinary. There's just like... It's like the difference between a drum machine and live drums. It's just unmissable. You absolutely, totally, as soon as you hear a real laugh, it just stands out.
And are people very good then at telling that difference?
Yes, people are very good. There's some variation. Some people are better than others, but people generally are much, it's a very clear difference.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Sophie. I'm sure you might have other things to add to the discussion later on. So before we come to our next guest, Joe Banks, I'm going to play... We've talked about other animals, the beluga whale, the elephant, which can speak in Korean, and I'm going to... play a track by Emma Bennett, which works with birdsong.
Deeper. It's got a richer, deep starts lower this time, and then it's a little bit of a little trickling, and making so much noise.
Then it stops.
Ooh, this one goes down, and then a chip of flowers, and then a chip comes up. It goes, this is a different chip, a bit happier, it goes, it sounds like a flute. Choom, ba ding, dong. It's got a more bubbly song,
and then it goes a really fast bit, and then again, and then it stops.
Goes little
it goes
wing,
a little ding, 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 ding,
and places lots of little notes. Oh, funk, chuck, 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 chuck,
organ, organ,
that was a bit
organ going down,
organ going down, down, organ going, like a little organ or a flute. Ooh, and then it stops it with a slow one.
Ooh, chop, 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 like a doo-doo.
So you've just heard a piece by the artist and performance writer Emma Bennett called Robin, in which she tries to replicate the sound of a robin's song by altering the pitch and rhythm of her own verbal descriptions. And Emma is also going to be speaking and performing at the symposium on Friday. Our next guest in the studio is Joe Banks, an installation artist, electronic musician and researcher, who's best known for his work with the art project Disinformation. Since 1996, Disinformation's been exploring the creative potential of electromagnetic noise, including radio noise from live mains electricity, from lightning, from high-voltage medical apparatus and from the sun. And in 1999, Joe started Rorschach Audio, a research project which focused on illusions of sound and took a critical approach to these allegedly supernatural voices that can be heard in recordings of electronic noise. He's published a book based on this research, again called Rorschach Audio, which is available from Strange Attractor Press. Welcome to the studio, Joe.
Hey.
And I think you've got a couple of these recordings from the 70s, which we're going to start off with, is that right?
Yeah, I guess these were probably made in the late 60s, but they were published in 1971. The background to all this, the sort of clip that we're about to play, is that in the late 1950s, a Swedish artist called Friedrich Jorgensen started making wildlife recordings and found human voices intruding on the tapes that he made outdoors, you know, sort of like taking an open reel tape recorder into a field and rolling out a long cable, which effectively acted as a kind of radio antenna, and picked up stray communications chatter of one sort or another. I mean, presumably from kind of passing planes and boats and, you know, maybe the local emergency services or something like that. He sort of developed this theory that he was either communicating with aliens or his deceased relatives. And he wrote several books about this in Swedish and languished more or less in semi-obscurity until his work was picked up by another guy who's a Latvian psychologist called Konstantin Radive, parapsychologist, really. And Radive wrote originally in German, as it's apparently not uncommon for educated Latvians to speak German and Latvian. So he went to the Frankfurt Book Fair in the late 60s and persuaded an English publisher to translate his book. And he produced this book called Breakthrough, you know, implying a sort of breakthrough to the other side, you know, to the spirit world or whatever. You know, it was him that... Radive that effectively sort of kicked off what's referred to as the electronic voice phenomena movement. And, you know, people who follow this scene believe that they've proved the existence of the afterlife. And he published this book, Breakthrough, in 1971. And as a sort of a freebie with the book, or a sort of promotional record was produced to help promote the book, that was given to journalists and stuff like that. It was like a 7-inch single with some of his best recordings on it.
A text spoken by the voices and the sound volume are exactly the same as in the original recording. to help the air adapt itself to the strange rhythm, rapidity, and softness of the voice entity's speech. Each utterance is repeated several times. The voices here selected are grouped according to the persons addressed and their respective answers, followed by a translation and explanation. They are examples chosen to give the reader a breakthrough, an acoustic illustration of the material presented in the book. The listener is asked to read any text spoken in languages he does not know, with particular attention, so that he may be able to grasp each separate word phonetically. Please note the commentary that goes with each voice text, as the meaning of some utterances can only be understood in context with the situation that gave rise to them.
The first voice is that of Margarete Petrowski, who had told the experimenter during her lifetime that she did not believe in an existence after death. After her passing, the experimenter asked her how she felt in the beyond, and a voice, identified as coming from Margarete, answered, "Bedenke, ich bin." German, "Imagine, I am." Again we hear Margarete Petrowski's voice, this time calling her former employer, Dr. Zenta Maurina. Zenta. Now the experimenter asks if Margarete can hear him, and a voice replies, "Kostya, ja." German, "Kostya, yes." The voice then calls the experimenter's family name, Raudive, but shortens it to Raudiv. And now we hear in Latvian and German, "Koste, tu tik na." "Koste, you are so near." Now the experimenter calls the Russian poet Vladimir Mayakovsky, and a voice answers, "Mayakovsky." The experimenter tells the poet how difficult it is to convince people of the reality of the voice phenomenon, and in reply comes a statement which is typical for Mayakovsky's personality. "Konstantin, pluj." In Russian, "Konstantin, spit on it."
Tell us about these recordings.
Well, it is probably fairly obvious. The analogy I make in the book is sort of between the interpretation of these kind of ambiguous sounds and the Rorschach ink blot test. The risk of stating the obvious, it's the sort of famous concept that if you fold a bit of paper and splash ink on it and then unfold it so that you get a symmetrical abstract pattern, you know, people have a tendency to see, you know, faces of angels and demons and monsters, fish, whatever, rabbits, bats in these sort of forms, and that the interpretation of those kind of shapes was proposed by the psychologist Hermann Rorschach as being a sort of means of assessing people's personality. You know, the idea that the interpretation revealed something about the person who was projecting meaning onto these abstract forms. And, you know, this is loosely applied in my book as, you know, a sort of explanatory metaphor for the process by which people feel that these voices are these recordings are personally significant for them.
Yeah.
I'm certainly not the first person who's pointed out that EVP recordings, or really EVP, is more of a belief system than a set of recordings. It's a bit silly, really. It's not really true. I'm not the first person to have said that, but what I try and demonstrate in the book is that, in fact, on not just one, but quite a few different levels, the experiments that EVP researchers were and are still conducting are basically psychology experiments. They're not experiments into a material supernatural phenomenon or immaterial phenomenon or an external supernatural phenomenon. That would be a better way of putting it. They're actually psychology experiments, or specifically psychoacoustics experiments. And the analogy between EVP and psychoacoustics experiments works out reliably with quite a few different examples on quite a few different levels.
Mm.
And the next clip we're going to play is probably the most vivid demonstration of that analogy, or certainly one of the most entertaining ones. And it's really what gave me the idea for the whole project. I read an article about this recording in Scientific American magazine in 1996. And the recording itself is prepared by an English psychologist working in America called Diana Deutsch, who's a professor at San Diego University. And she recorded herself saying two neutral words, which are the words high and low, and then they're edited so that they alternate rapidly in alternating stereo channels. The idea is that listeners listening to these recordings over stereo loudspeakers tend to sort of perceive illusory words beginning to form in their perception or their hearing of these sounds.
So a note to listeners, put your radio onto stereo now.
Yeah, it works a bit better. It doesn't really work over headphones. I don't know why. And also it works a lot better if you listen to it for a long time. But,
okay.
This is quite a short clip. But nonetheless, you should get an impression of what's going on from listening to this example.
We've just been discussing what we were all hearing. I think a few of us were getting pipeline, play.
It was very interesting, the difference between listening to the headphones and listening to it in the room.
Yeah.
She was telling me to die on the headphones, but then it was completely disappeared in the room.
Yeah. Session. Yeah.
So,
yeah. It's good, isn't it?
It's great. And I think if you listen to it even longer, you say that you get these more strange effects.
Yeah, I mean, there are sort of three levels on which it operates. One is that you just get very briefly, you get this kind of sense of it sort of drifting around a bit, which is in itself an illusion. It's completely mechanical and repetitive. There are some artists who've done things like this, like Steve Reich did this thing, Different Trains, where you get tape loops that are shifting against themselves. There's no shifting in this. All the shifting that appears to be taking place is taking place inside your head. The second level is, which again is an illusion, is that it sort of seems to resemble words like you were describing. And the third level is that it really sounds like somebody's actually whispering in your ear. And in my experience, you have to listen to the recording over and over again for quite a long time for that to happen. But when it does happen, it's really unnerving. But all three of those levels of experience are an illusion.
And of course, the analogy that you draw is between these kind of psychoacoustic experiments and the EVP that we heard in the first recording.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that EVP researchers often don't mention, other than the fact that they set up these kind of seances where they call out to the spirit world out loud, and then they record stuff using these, you know, microphones and tape recorders. Often there's a very long delay between the question and the answer, or the sort of announcement and the response. So they didn't tell you about that. The other thing is that there's absolutely standard practice is to listen to these recordings over and over and over again. So obviously what the Diana Deutsch tape has done is compress that repetition into a very small space of time. Yeah. But essentially it's the same process. If you, you know, listen to stuff over and over and over and over and over and over again, it's going to sort of statistically increase the chance that your brain can match some kind of meaningful pattern to it.
And even just listening to those recordings, you know, there's kind of nested levels of suggestion there. You know, Sophie was kind of exclaiming at the fact that what you were supposed to hear was announced before you heard it. And not only that, but then there's a really almost deeply poetic level of interpretation going on between the words, which are spoken in often several languages, cryptically. So, you know, there's this like whole sort of thing of decrypting going on out of these sounds.
Well, one of the ideas is that when, for instance, Radivay was conducting this research, he was essentially sort of psychoanalyzing himself, you know, and he wrote quite a long book called Breakthrough, reporting these kind of experiences. And in terms of the kind of poetry of it, you know, it's fairly dark stuff. It's obviously very heavily involved with bereavement. Right, and a lot of the kind of symbolism that he explores, or that is revealed to him quite explicitly in his descriptions of his recordings, is stuff to do with trauma, to do with the Second World War.
Yeah. Well, there's another kind of... Is that another historical context for these works, even though they're produced quite a lot later?
Well, you know, they can be produced at any time, and they will reflect the personalities of the and the experiences of the people who recorded them. But in his specific case, you know, a lot of the people in the sound art scene and in the arts generally who sort of promoted EVP have sort of overlooked some of the more embarrassing aspects of the actual story of the individuals that were involved with this. And also, you know, the religious element is quite a significant aspect to it as well.
Yeah. I know, because the reason I open up that question of the historical context is I know one of your parallel interests is in Gombrich and Art and Illusion, which you kind of relate to. So do you want to say something about that and just kind of introduce that topic?
There's an art historian, well, you know, really one of the most important art historians ever, called Ernst Gombrich, E.H. Gombrich. And he wrote this book called Art and Illusion in the early 60s, which sold tens of millions of copies. And I mean, arguably, it's the most important book of visual arts theory ever published. He was an Austrian emigre who left Austria to escape Nazism. During the Second World War, before he developed his career as an art historian, he worked for the BBC Monitoring Service as an expert linguist, monitoring German radio transmissions, so news broadcasts and military communications. So they would record these radio broadcasts on really, really rubbish transcription machines, you know, wax cylinder recorders, which were office dictation machines of the day, and try and extract, you know, usable intelligence from these recordings. And he wrote a sort of internal memorandum for the BBC Monitoring Service called Some Axioms, Musings and Hints on Hearing, which is really what set me on the path to sort of extrapolating an understanding of the psychological processes that are involved in EVP towards something that's more relevant to art in the most general sense, because the theories of sort of psychological projection, or the projective aspect of cognition, of perception, that he developed as a result of his practical experience working with these very bad sound recordings during the Second World War, very strongly influenced the ideas that he put forward about visual art in Art and Illusion. And he does talk about that in Art and Illusion. It's not secret by any means, but I think going back to what I said about Radivay, I think Gombrich didn't really like talking about the war. You know, people tend to think that it was, oh, it's really exciting stuff. You know, they're involved in all this kind of really sort of intensely political, you know, military intelligence work and stuff like that. But actually, you know, for a lot of emigres, that was a really, really bad experience. So, you know, he didn't sort of over-advertise the sound aspect of his theories about psychology because it, you know, this is my theory and it may be wrong, because it reminded him of the war.
But coming out of that, you have an idea that, in effect, a kind of democratisation, maybe, of a creative process, because everyone, when they're listening or watching, are kind of filling in things. So is that
I'm glad you mentioned that, actually, because that goes back very much to what was said earlier on about, you know, the kind of emphasis that was placed on evolutionary biology. The book's received a few reviews and people tend to focus on the debunking EVP side of it and the, you know, whether or not that's sort of contentious in relation to people in the arts who've explored EVP. But the real punchline of the book is that the psychological or cognitive processes that I'm talking about are rooted in evolutionary biology. To a large extent, most of the kind of feedback on the book has neglected that aspect of it, and it's extremely important. there is a little bit of a tendency for people to talk in terms of these kind of phenomena as being representative of sort of anomalous psychology. And the point that I'm trying to stress is that they're byproducts of normal processes of perception, which very, very much in terms of what you just said, you know, the ability for the mind to use intelligent guesswork, what the psychologist Hermann Helmholtz referred to as perceptual hypotheses, which just means guesswork, is enormously important to perception. In order to be able to sort of navigate very, very complex sensory environments and very noisy sensory environments, you need to be able to fill in the gaps and you need to be able to use intelligent guesswork. And there are some situations in which those guesses are wrong. You know, the mind makes guesses about the environment and those guesses turn out to be wrong and they're perceived as being illusions. But one of the paradoxes is that this illusion-creating sort of faculty, the perceptions that it creates are normally correct. Even though they have an illusory aspect, an imaginary aspect, they are 99.9% of the time correct and reliable representations of the external environment. And that's an interesting paradox. They're actually part of normal perceptual processes. They're not anomalous in that sense as a question of emphasis.
You know? Sophie, I wonder if you're nodding away. I wonder if you wanted to add something.
Absolutely. It's very easy to think of perception as being something being driven entirely by what's hitting your sense organs and then you interpret that. But it's absolutely correct. You're going out there with expectations about the world and what you're likely to see and what you're likely to hear, and it absolutely colours what you're perceiving. The best example I can think of recently is that film of a dog chasing the deer in Richmond Park, which for it was about 2 days when everybody was the guy was shouting, Benton, Benton, and it was Fenton. And it took a couple of, you know, and it was simply because that's the less common name. Just statistically, it was more likely we were hearing Benton, and we all heard Benton. And it took, you know, a certain couple of days, people, no, it's Fenton. And then, I can't even hear how I ever heard that as Benton. Now I know that it's Fenton. It's that simple. And it was lots of things that helped that. It was a noisy recording and, you know, other stuff. But it's definitely your, and we just do it absolutely continuously. You are interpreting the world based on what you expect to be there. Yeah. And when there's a mismatch, when there's a noisy situation, you can see really exaggerated.
Well, if you've just joined us, this is The Clear Spot on Resonance 104.4 FM. Today's programme is dedicated to the voice, in anticipation of a symposium that's taking place in London at the Science Museum's Dana Centre on Friday, the 16th of November. There'll be panel discussions about the social and political aspects of the voice, one on inhuman voices, which is going to feature deer larynxes, speaking computers and electronic voice phenomena and the like, and one panel on communication beyond speech with an emphasis on breath, singing and other distortions of spoken language. And it's to these distortions that we're going to turn now, as I'd like to welcome my third studio guest, Pradheep Shanmugalingam. Pradheep is a PhD student at the Institute of Cognitive Neuroscience at UCL, and his research uses functional MRI scanning, a brain scanning technique, to address questions of how our brains process spoken language. And Pradheep, you're using a kind of phenomenon called sine-wave speech. And there's another one here. So we've got two very brief clanger-like squeakings. What's going on there?
So that was sine wave speech. So those sounds were actually computer generated and they were modelled on original speech recordings. And most people, when they hear that sound, if you don't tell them it's speech, they don't realise it. They hear it as meaningless electronic beeps. But once you tell them that it's speech, then they can start to hear words in those sentences. So those two sentences were actually the clown had a funny face and the car engine's running. So I don't know if you want to play them again, and then listeners might be able to hear those words.
Well, I certainly heard the clown had a funny face. It's amazing. They do kind of pop out at you, don't they?
Exactly. And so we've kind of exploited that fact in our imaging experiment. So sine wave speech has been around for ages. It was discovered in the 70s, and people have been doing lots of experiments on it since. But there's only been a few brain scanning experiments on sine wave speech, and there's only been one other experiment that's used whole sentences. And so what we were interested in doing, because it's really important when you're doing a brain scanning experiment, is to have a good control condition to what you're always comparing one thing to something else. And so what we want to do is we want to capture which parts of the brain are involved in processing speech, but we need to have a condition where they're listening to, our subjects are listening to a sound and not processing that as speech versus listening to a sound and processing it as speech. So in other experiments, people have tried to come up with complicated sounds that match the complexity of speech. So Sophie was talking before about how complicated the speech signal is. But the nice thing about sine wave speech is that you can argue home your point there, saying that you've made an absolute perfect acoustic comparison there, where you make a subject listen to a whole range of sentences in an initial session where they don't realise that it's speech. Then you tell them it's speech and you're playing them the exact same sentences again in a second block. And you can compare the brain activity in these two conditions and say that the differences that you see are showing up brain regions that are specifically involved in processing
right,
speech.
Okay. And is this anything to do with expectations in the way we were talking about just a few minutes ago? So when you think it's speech, is there some kind of attention-driven activity, or is it very much... I mean, how does it work?
Well, so that's the thing. I mean, it's such a fast effect. So in our experiment, we played 50 sentences in our first block, and then we just told them that those items are actually speech derived, and we just played them three example sentences right. with their clear speech recordings, and then let them listen to the whole 50 sentences again. So what we think we're capturing is a very it's not really a kind of extended learning effect. It's like a sudden switch of attention to listening out for something that you expect to be able to hear.
And is that something which, you know, that ability to kind of identify speech like that and just to kind of latch onto it, is that something that's important for humans to do then? Is that why we're so good at it? Maybe this is something Sophie wants to jump in on.
There is a whole argument about the extent to which speech is dealt with differently in the brain, but I think it's certainly the case that we have a spectacular level of expertise in dealing with speech, and you can see peculiarities in how we process speech that's different from other sounds. So if you play people, speech sounds like ah, ah, those are two different ahs, which you probably wouldn't hear them as being different. If there are other sorts of sounds I can make with my mouth, like which aren't speech sounds in English, they are in some African languages. We're much better at telling the difference between two sounds than we are between two t sounds, because one we hear is speech, and when you hear it as speech, you're sort of lumping them all together because you're sort of trying to get up to words and sentences and comprehension, and you don't need to worry about that surface variation. Other sounds, we can hear the surface variation much better, so it's almost like our expertise in speech makes us worse at some aspects of processing it, but it seems to be because you're cohering the information at a more central level and over bigger sort of chunks, and that's what you need to do to understand speech. To understand speech, you don't need to know that cat's made of cat. You need to be able to get to cat. And that seems to be one of the things that's associated with what I guess people have called over the years like a speech mode of listening, that you are somehow dealing with this thing as speech. And people have meant different things by speech mode over the years, but to me it means something. It means that doing that kind of listening in a more sort of general way, and sort of you're trying to group things into that linguistic framework.
Okay, so Pradheep, can you say something about where you think these experiments are going to lead? What's the importance of doing this work, and where might it go beyond this?
So one of the motivations for doing this work was that there's always this big debate within brain scanning experiments on speech processing, which is how good are your acoustic comparisons when you're trying to capture a speech-specific effect? How much can you say that the brain regions you're seeing are involved in processing speech, and how much of them are just would be responding to any kind of complex sound and aren't specifically involved in speech? So the motivation for doing this study was to say that we're completely accounting for the acoustics in this effect, and we're really trying to capture speech-specific effects and the speech network, and trying to isolate the speech network in the brain. But so one of the other things that I'm interested in is, though, that because sine-wave speech is this massively reduced signal, it's kind of it seems to be abstracting out the key elements of the speech signal that we tap into when we're listening to speech. And one of the interesting things is to see if one of the things we used in our experiment was we used non-speech items where they were similar in structure to these sine-wave speech sentences in terms of having different kind of patterns of modulating sine-wave tones, but they were unintelligible because we messed with these stimuli in a particular way. And one of the things I'm interested in is seeing if you generated these non-speech items from different languages, whether some of them would be more likely to trigger false percepts of words than others because that language's structure happens to be closer to your own or more different from your own.
Yeah. So we're back to this idea of kind of perceiving language in something which actually where there's no pattern.
Exactly. Yeah. And being kind of tuned to hear to hear words and extract them from particular patterns.
And not from others. Yeah. And so there's something about sine wave speech in particular that makes this a really good stimulus for using this, is there?
Yeah. I mean, it's the idea that because you're reducing it so much and you're using such a distorted stimulus, you're creating more space for your imagination to run wild and create all these false percepts and try and construct meaning from what you've got.
Oh, thank you. Our final studio guest is Carolyn McGettigan, who works in the psychology department at Royal Holloway, University of London. Carolyn's current research interest is in a number of areas, one of which is in vocal identity and the ways we recognise other people by their voice and how we express our own identity in the voice. And I wonder, Carolyn, if you could say something in general terms about this area and your interest in it.
one of the things that's interesting about vocal identity is that I think historically, and also in the field of neuroscience where I'm working, people have tended to think that the voice is just an auditory face. It's just something we express ourselves with. It's something we use every day to communicate with other humans, and therefore it must operate along the sort of same rules. And historically, of course, it was easier to go around the world showing people pictures of faces and asking them what they thought, or categorizing emotions and that kind of thing. It was much more difficult to have auditory recordings that were good quality to do that with. So this sort of face literature has sort of taken precedence over the auditory literature. And one of the things about voices is that they're not like faces. Your voice can change quite a lot through the course of a day. I mean, actually, this whole experience of speaking down a microphone and listening to myself through headphones is quite unusual for me. And so I probably speak in a slightly different way than I would normally. In fact, one of the critical things about how I hear my own voice over headphones compared with how I hear it in the real world is that I'm getting much more of the auditory product of what I sound like over these headphones, whereas through the day I sort of get much more feedback through the bone conduction and the vibrations from the vocal folds coming up sort of through my face and the tissue in my face, and giving me a sort of different sense of what my voice sounds like. So in many respects, recognizing other people by the voice alone and recognizing ourselves by the voice alone are quite different from how we deal with faces. So we're not particularly great at recognizing other people by their voice alone. We can do it, but there is a reason, of course, why when I call you up, even though you've got caller ID, I still say, hi, it's Carolyn, right? I don't just start speaking, because you need a little bit of time to get into that. The voice is something, of course, which exists over time. It's a fast fading signal. That's one element of it. But also, I think generally, we're just not quite as good at recognizing voices. And that's also because our voices change a lot. So if I have a bit of a cold, my voice is going to sound slightly different. If I'm a little bit tired in the morning, if I'm going through some sort of slightly different emotional state, then that's going to impact upon how my voice sounds in ways that kind of render the voice less recognisable than if, for example, I felt a bit upset and I began to cry here in the studio. Yeah. You'd still know it was me sitting here crying, even if you just see me. But if I started to speak and you didn't know who it was, maybe my tearful voice coming over the headphones would not be immediately recognisable as me in the same way.
So it's kind of a more fluid...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And these things can happen both unconsciously and consciously. So, you know, I've described a lot of things about how mood and so on might inflect how I speak. Social context can affect how we speak as well. So there's a lot of evidence that people align in conversation, and that kind of facilitates discourse comprehension. And that's not just in terms of how we speak. So there's evidence that people will begin to use the same inflections or sort of converge on certain pronunciations. It can be all sorts of things, like how we gesture, how we stand as we face each other if we're having a conversation, even how we breathe. People can start to breathe in sort of synchrony. So all of these elements kind of come together to make the voice a rather more flexible tool for communication. And for me, that's why it's so fascinating, of course.
Yeah.
Because there are all these different elements to how our voices can be changed, as I just mentioned, unconsciously, but also consciously. So I've been looking at that in some recent work.
Mm. And I suppose for a neuroscientist, I mean, this is why I find it interesting, because you as a neuroscientist are dealing with perhaps a tension in that the most powerful tool you have is something which will enable you to look at, I don't know, blood oxygen levels, changes in the brain. But you're kind of talking about things, you know, in terms of gesture, body language, emotion, all these things which I guess historically are quite hard to actually come at from that point of view. Is that something that you find, is that correct?
I think that's a reasonable assessment, certainly, of the neuroimaging literature, because one of the constraints of putting someone in an MRI scanner is that they can't really move very much. Yeah. They have to lie on their back. It's dark. It's a bit weird. And all of those things, of course, are going to impact upon naturalistic behaviour. And one of the big constraints, of course, is that you want to restrict the times at which people move in the scanner, and when you allow them to speak, for example, in a speech production experiment. So that would impact on the ability to have something like a naturalistic conversation. So what you find is that sort of historically in the neuroscience literature looking at speech, we have these sort of paradigms where you have a signal and a receiver, and you have someone lying in the scanner either saying something that is recorded or listening to something. My take on it is that the literature has very much looked at a kind of information transfer. What's the linguistic signal and how is it getting across in whichever direction? There has been more recent work now trying to get more toward trying to investigate conversation, because really that's what we do every day. That's what I'm doing with you now. And that's really how we use language, and everything before now to a certain extent has approximated that by trying to get people to listen to stories or sentences or something like that. But this sort of natural turn-taking behaviour, the social cognition benefits or mechanisms by which we interact with each other and sort of form bonds or transfer information are all very important. So actually work is beginning to look at that, and people are doing sort of more adventurous things now, like getting people to engage in a map reading task where someone lies in the scanner and reads out instructions for how to get to a certain place on a map. Then someone else later on is scanned while they listen to those instructions. Mm-hmm. And then you can basically look for the correlations across the brain signals of the speaker and the listener to see sort of where the sort of points of convergence are in terms of getting the information across from one person to the other. So there are moves in that direction. Yeah. I think it's a very pertinent point, though, that really, for a lot of what we've done, we've not quite yet been able to really strike on that, especially in the neuroscience field.
Taxing your creativity, isn't it, to try and sort of work within those parameters. I know you've brought a clip which I'm just going to play now. This is something, part of an experiment that you've done recently, is that correct?
Yeah, that's right.
Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of... Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water.
It's incredible. It was four different women.
So, of course, I'm testing your voice identity skills now. You've had some 5 minutes of listening to me. So this was a recording made in a recent experiment that we did in the MRI scanner, where we had participants trying to consciously and deliberately change their vocal identity. So I've mentioned quite a lot about, you know, how these things can change with mood and age and the social context. But you can get people, if they really try, to change how they sound. And I was, in fact, one of the participants in the experiment. And actually, strangely, this experiment, I think I was a participant in 2008, and somehow my voice sounds different to me from how it does now. So I don't know whether I've just become more decrepit and aged.
The long-term effects of pretending to be Australian, maybe.
Yeah. So just for everyone's information, the second one was South African. Then there was Janet Street Porter and Marilyn Monroe. But actually, the reason I picked my own examples of this, and I don't think they're necessarily the best in the experiment, but I gave myself permission to use these in this broadcast, is because, okay, I'm not an amazing mimic, and none of our participants necessarily were. Some were better than others. But what we can do is we can systematically, without very much instruction, change the way in which we articulate the same sentence. So here it was Jack and Jill went up the hill, in order to try and modulate how other people recognise us. And we can do that in a whole load of different ways. So I'm changing the pitch of my voice, or the quality of it, the sort of harmonic quality of it, or how I pronounce, you know, individual speech segments. And people can do this, of course, very successfully when they want to disguise their voice. If you think about forensic context for this, it's actually very difficult in a court of law to convincingly recognise a person from a recording, a noisy recording, a 999 call or something like that. So people can do this, who can do it consciously. And we were very interested in how this happens in the brain. So we had a bunch of amateur impressionists, let's say. We recruited them safe in the knowledge that they were happy to come in and try and do impressions. And we wanted to see what parts of the brain would be activated or enhanced in their activation when trying to change vocal identity. So one of the regions that we found that was quite prominent in this task was the left anterior insula. So this is a part of the frontal lobe of the brain, which has previously been very strongly associated with speech production. So patients who have lesions to this part of the brain can have terrible difficulties in getting speech out and making the very complex articulations of speech. And that is one thing that it's certainly, there's a sort of clinical context that it's associated with speech. Mm. And it's come up in lots of activation studies with healthy individuals as well. Now, what we were doing in this experiment was we weren't asking people to say different things. We were getting to say the same thing, but in different ways. And so my actual personal interpretation of what we found is that maybe it's something to do with a more holistic approach to the way in which we get the sounds out of the body from the mouth in order to try and sound like different people. So one of the things we noticed in our experiment was people, when they tried to change their voice, whether it was to do accents, we had them doing lists of accents, or whether they were doing impersonations of Janet Street Porter and the like, one of the things we found they did was they spoke more loudly. They tended to raise the pitch of their voice. They tended to take a little bit longer to say Jack and Jill went up the hill. And all of those things actually require all sorts of interesting things going on in the vocal tract and around the articulators. But also they require very, very fine control of breathing and modulation of that. So if I want to make myself sound louder and higher in pitch, I've got to actually do something from the intercostal muscles between the ribs to change all of that. So I'm quite interested in sort of that element of really speech not being something that just happens on your lips, but something that happens sort of from your belly up.
I suppose it's also not about the content of the speech. You know, you're repeating the same element over and over, so you're really kind of pushing all the focus onto that bodily, almost like actor-like process of producing things that you already know very, very well.
That's right. And so, I mean, a lot of work over the years has looked at people saying different types of, you know, novel words and playing about with what parts of the brain are engaged when the word becomes more complicated to articulate or it has more syllables or something like that. And these similar regions have come up in the frontal, sort of left frontal lobe of the brain. Here we're really tapping into something different. So we're allowing people not to have to think, oh no, what am I going to say next? They know what they have to say. They've just got to think about the means in which they say it. So then just beyond that basic finding in the insula, we compared directly these two different types of impersonation. So one was accents, sort of generic, like do a Glaswegian accent now, please. Yeah. And the other one was do an impersonation of Billy Connolly. So now specific identities and any range of selections that the participants came up with themselves. And what we found there was that regions that have previously been associated in the recognition of familiar voices or other people's voices were more active when trying to do impersonations of individuals. And that was actually quite a novel demonstration.
So it's tied up with that recognising a person and maybe picturing a person?
Well, yeah, we wonder whether what we've seen is a sort of auditory imagery of the voice of the intended impersonation. And what we found actually using an analysis that sort of explored how these different parts of the brain speak to each other during the experiment, we found that there was an enhanced connectivity or an enhanced interaction between these imagery regions and then that region I mentioned before that may be associated with the difference in the actual doing of the output of speech. So when people were trying to impersonate specific individuals, they were activating these auditory imagery areas more strongly, and then they were also working more strongly with the anterior insula compared with when they were just doing something more general.
Well, thank you. If you've been enjoying this dip into the wide ocean of the voice, then have a look at the website, www.thevoxlab.org/symposium. That's got all the details about the upcoming day of discussions and performances. Sophie Scott will be there, Joe Banks, Pradheep Shanmugalingam and Carolyn McGettigan and Emma Bennett, all of whom you heard earlier. Thanks to all of you. Other speakers include the artist Lawrence Abu Hamdan, Johnny Robinson from the British Library, theatre maker Hannah Silver, artist Aura Satz, Roger K. Moore, David Rebby, Holly Pester, Mikhail Karakis, Antonia Barnett McIntosh and Adam Crockett, and Carol Watts and Will Montgomery. So it's a day of performances and discussions and papers. Resonance 104.4 FM are going to be broadcasting recordings from this day towards the end of the year. And so to end the programme, to play us out, I'm going to play a recording of the poet Holly Pester performing her work, News Piece.
Wednesday, 20th, the 7th, 2011. Failure. Hacking. Fall short. Hacking. Failure. Deplorable. News International. Phone hacking. Shaving foam. Hacking. Transparency. Pressure. Hacking. Aid.